So this is what we're going to do. Let's see how well we get to have a couple of groups. And the first one is the description or the first raise the hand and
Facebook, YouTube, Amazon.
If you'd like to stand up, you can. I don't know if you must go on the plate. So you know, you're going to buy the field. And you have to find out how you would say a verse or how you say scripture. So you don't know. First, then you can tell me the first is the scripture that you have. Okay. So, all I see on the short of the day. For all I see on the short. Romans 3:23. What is James 1 and 12
Oh, we had, I'm sorry, I forgot your name, sister. Yes, Yvonne. Yes, Yates. Amen. All right. Isaiah 41:13. Sister Grills. Amen. Fear not, I will help thee. Yes, he will. Lord is always with us, and he will go through us through all trials and tribulations. Philippians 4:6-8. Sister William. What's the rest? 7, 8. It was 6-8. Right. That's right. Don't be anxious for anything. Always know that the Lord is there to help calm your fears. Call upon him all the time. Psalms 31:24. Sister Johnson. Won't he do it? That's right. He will do it. So keep your head in all situations through the work of an evangelist. Okay, that was done. Be strong and let your heart take courage. So we always have to remember that. Wait on the Lord. He will come eventually. He just won't come when we want him to all the time. But he will come. Philippians 1:6. Sister Yates. Almost. Jesus is going to, he starts what we believe in him, we accept him, he's with us, and he's going to keep molding us as we go on throughout life until we see him. Exodus 14:14. Sister Williams, Exodus 14:14. Sister Williams, yes. Hold your peace. Let the Lord fight your battles. Oh, I'm sorry. The boss has spoken. The boss has spoken. Okay. Thank you. The rules have been upgraded to closing your Bible in between each verse. Sister Williams Darlene has two. Sister Grills has one. You got 18. Okay, all right. Oh, she has two. So it's a tie game thus far between those two. The Yates get twice. Okay. All right. So let's see here. John 3:16. Well, technically, she stood up. So Sister Pam Onowa stood up. But Sister Carolyn shouted it out. But we said stand up, right? Sister Bird said stand up. Sister Bird Williams said stand up. That's the new rule. So Sister Onowa, John 3:16, please. Everlasting life. Amen, amen. That's right. We shall all have everlasting life as long as we believe. So those of you in virtual world, if you are not a believer, it's time for you to get it right and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. This is your opportunity to do so. So let's see here. Genesis 1:1. Sister Grill. Okay. Romans 12:12. Romans, oh, that's it already. Romans 12:12. Sister Yolanda acting up down there. All right. It's the Anawa. Oh, uh-oh. Well, Sister Grills didn't pop up fast enough. Rejoicing in hope. In all our trials and tribulations, we also need to be patient. Patience is a virtue, but many of us don't have that. I'm one of those that don't always have the great patience either. So, never. No. So continuing in prayer and supplication, our patience will eventually come, but it's still a struggle for some of us. Okay, so let me see here. Oh, we have bonuses. Romans 8:28-29. Romans 8:28-29. Somebody gotta hop up. Who gonna hop up? Uh-oh. Sister Yolanda. It was Sister Williams that actually had her hand up, but she didn't hop up. But you go ahead. Go ahead, Sister Yolanda. You got up. That's good. Right. Called according to his purpose, not our purpose, his purpose. So we have to remember that. Okay. So we've had such a wonderful time, and I do thank you for participating in this. I thought it was pretty cool. Kind of reminded me of Sunday school. I never won because somebody else's fingers were always faster, but you know. So my final question is, how many books are in the Bible? Did I hear a 91 or something? How many books are in the Bible? Thank you. Thank you, ladies, once again. So we'll have our speaker come up after she's introduced. And the winner is Sister Grill. We do have a basket for you. It's going to be taken over to you. So, well, we do have a car for you as well, but it may be in the basket about this big. Sorry. Thank you again, ladies and gentlemen, and little gentlemen.
Flowing, the comforter is close.
All right, before we get started, everybody stand up. Check it off. Midweek, Monday was rough. Tuesday was a little something, something. Wednesday was special. Shake it off. Let's prepare ourselves to hear Pastor Courtney Hauser. Are you ready? You may be seated. Pastor Courtney Hauser discovered early on in her life that God could use pain as a springboard into purpose and passion. Growing up in Cleveland, Ms. Courtney witnessed and experienced domestic violence, physical abuse, sexual abuse, and family dysfunction. But God, Courtney found hope and healing through her salvation in Christ. I said, but God. Courtney Hauser is a wife. She is a mother. She is a counselor, a pastor, and an author. She became determined to lead an emotionally healthy life and to help others transition from her book, Victims to Survivors. Now I'll share with y'all that I got this bio and I had to Google sis because this is kind of bad. This is a lot of information about a powerful sister. So you can buy her book on Amazon, Victims to Survivors. I will have you know that I did purchase it and I have read it. Pastor Hauser holds a master's degree in clinical mental health counseling from Ashland Theological Seminary, and she has used her clinical and spiritual education to bring healing and mental health awareness to the body of Christ. You know, we say now, trust Jesus and also get a therapist. Amen, amen, if y'all don't claim it. She is the owner of the Healing Care Counselor Center, and that is a place where those who are struggling with depression, relationship problems, family dysfunction, and many other issues can receive Holy Spirit-led counseling sessions. Courtney is also the founder and host of Victim to Survivor, a Christian mental health organization for women survivors of abuse. And outside of counseling, again, she is the wife of Pastor Mario, and they serve together as parents to Faith, Taylor, and Josiah. So please, ladies and our gentlemen here, welcome, Pastor Courtney Hauser.
Thank you. All right. Can you all hear me okay? Perfect. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm super excited to be here with you all this evening. First, I want to say thank you to Pastor Cash and thank you to Lady Krista. Thank you so much for having me here tonight. We got a chance to meet them and hang out with them last year, and it's always nice to connect with other couples in ministry. My husband and I, we've been blessed to be married for the last 8 years. We parent three beautiful children, as you already heard, and we've been serving as leaders in ministry for over 10 years. And we currently are going on a new venture in the beginning stages of planting our own church. So please pray for us as we do that. So I want to give you a little bit of a backdrop. I know you all heard my bio, but I want to tell you how many of those things came about, and then we'll get into tonight's lesson. So about 15 years ago, shortly after I started my walk with Christ, I went off to college to begin studying psychology. And the Lord began to speak to me at that time about something that was pretty taboo: mental health and Jesus. As I would read my psychology books, I began to hear the word of God. As I would read the word of God, I would hear psychological principles. And so God started to reveal to me that he was concerned about not only our physical healing, because in church we hear a lot about that. We hear a lot of testimonies about being healed from cancer or being healed from diabetes. But he said to me that he was also concerned about our mental and our emotional well-being. Not only was he just concerned about it, but that he wanted to heal us from the issues of life that have created pain and dysfunction. He even took me on my own journey. As you all heard, some of the things that I went through, I also have my book here tonight. And if you want to hear more about my journey, you'll be able to purchase it afterwards. But he took me on my own journey from being a victim to then learning how to be a survivor and no longer being in that victim mentality, and then going from surviving to thriving. So I'm going to speak to you from that place tonight. I'm going to talk a little bit, teach a little bit, but then I'm going to share three keys to healing emotional wounds. Three keys. So if I have any note takers, it's a good place to write your title. Three keys to healing emotional wounds. See, because many of us, we've been taught to serve. How many of us have grown up in the church or have been in the church for a while, right? So we've been taught to serve, but many of us have never been taught to heal. We've been taught to church. We can church with the best of them. We've been taught to praise, but we've never been taught to sit in silence and face our pain. We know Jesus as the savior of the world, but do we know him as the surgeon of our hearts? I know I'm not alone in this room, and you can vote with me when I say that many of us in some way, shape, or form have been wounded. Some of our wounds may be a result of childhood. Some of our wounds may be a result of broken marriages. Some of our wounds may be a result of abuse, things that happened to us before we were in Christ. And let's be honest, things that have happened to us while in Christ. Because even though we don't talk about it as much, sometimes there's this mentality that when you get saved, everything's all right. And when you get saved, you don't go through anything. When you get saved, there's no more pain, there's no more fear, there's no more worry. And if I'm honest with you guys tonight, that just isn't the truth. While in Christ, many of us have experienced pain due to unmet expectations and disappointments. Some of us have experienced pain just due to living in a fallen world and things happening. So when we begin to talk about wounds, let's go to the physical first. A physical wound, by definition, is a cut or a break in the skin that causes the flesh to be open or exposed. And because our skin is a protective outer layer, once it's been broken, it leaves that space open, that space of flesh open, vulnerable, and likely to get infected if not treated properly. It's second nature for us that when we recognize a physical wound on our bodies, the very first thing that we do is clean it, right? We reach for the peroxide to get the bacteria out, and we get ready to bandage it up and make sure that it heals properly to keep bacteria from getting in it. See, we automatically have this understanding that if we don't act quickly enough, bacteria can get in from the object that hurt us. Follow me, y'all. That object can be the external environment or something that's already on our own skin. But for some reason, and I have my theories, especially historically in the Black church, when it comes to emotional wounds, we don't have the same sense of urgency. But an emotional wound is very similar to a physical wound. An emotional wound may look like betrayal. It may look like being lied on. It may look like being talked about. And let's go a little bit deeper if that's okay. It may look like being molested. It may look like being neglected. It may look like being rejected or abandoned. It may look like being cheated on. It may look like being left out. And when that violation, whatever it might be, when that violation breaks through the surface of your heart, it leaves you open and vulnerable, just like a physical wound. And see, if we don't act quickly enough to clean that emotional wound out, bacteria can get in. Emotional bacteria, that is. So what is emotional bacteria? It's those toxic thoughts that the enemy suggests that we eventually end up coming into alignment with. Thoughts like, nobody cares about me. God must have forgotten about me. God must be angry with me. Thoughts like, I will never trust somebody like that again. Thoughts like, I am the best person to protect myself. Thoughts like, if I keep this wall up, no one can ever hurt me again. And so either we come into alignment with the thoughts that the enemy suggests to us, or we can begin to come into alignment with the toxic words that have been spoken over us. Many of us have been called names like stupid, ugly, not good enough, will never amount to anything, and other names that I won't even speak over the pulpit, but you all know what I'm talking about. If you've ever been called something other than your name, would you just raise your hand for me so I know that I'm not in the room by myself? Amen. Amen. So we're in this thing together. We understand. We have similar experiences. And when that kind of emotional bacteria, when it's set too long in your mind, your heart becomes infected, and it can lead to the death of the real you. Many of us have become so, and I feel this in my spirit, many of us have become so hard and so defensive. And we've tried to say, oh, that's just how I am. That's just my personality. No, that's just your trauma response and your way of trying to protect yourself from people hurting you. And so when emotional bacteria gets in and it sits in the heart too long, it sits in the mind too long, we try to figure out a way to fight it off. And a lot of times, we really don't know how to fight it off. We try to fight it off by blocking anybody else from getting in and getting close to it. And sometimes we even block God out. But we'll get to that a little later. But it leads to the death of the real you. The you that was loving. The you that was caring. The you that was soft. And instead, you begin to lead from a place of hurt, distrust, insecurity, and defense. I wanna just take a pause right quick and just feel the pulse of the room. Is anybody resonating with what I'm saying? Did anybody at one point used to be a little softer? Used to be a little more trusting? Used to be a little more kind, a little more caring? See, the thing about emotional wounds is we could be hurting for years and never tell anyone about it. I remember one time I was praying for someone and she began to share some things with me. And I was getting ready to ask her, how long have you been holding this in? And I asked the Lord before I asked her. He told me, and then she confirmed it verbally, and she said, 40 years. 40 years. That is a long time to hold on to pain. And we were never created to carry pain, to hold on to it, which is why when you carry pain for so long, it begins to destroy your body. It begins to cause you to have headaches and stomach aches and all kinds of pain and frustrations in your physical body because God did not create us to hold on to it. Yes, we were created to be able to experience pain, but there's a process that we're supposed to go through to release it, which I'll get into in just a second. So we could be hurting for years and never tell anybody about it. Has anyone ever experienced something so painful that you kept it a secret and never told anybody? We've been taught from childhood, because this kind of mentality is ingrained in us. What goes on in this house stays in this house. We must have all grew up in the same kind of house, because we all know how that works, right? See, we've been taught that strength is the ability to endure, the ability to suffer in silence. And maybe that's man's view of strength, or really should I call it safety? But I don't know about you, but I don't want man's strength. I need God's strength. And my Bible in 2 Corinthians 12:9 says that his strength is made perfect in our weaknesses. And if you go back when you have a moment to read this scripture, you will see that Paul is sharing about a conversation that he had with God. He's talking to God about a wound, a thorn in his flesh. And he was asking God to take it away. But instead of God relieving him of the thorn, God begins to talk to Paul about how Paul's pain draws out the strength and grace of God. See, we don't experience the fullness of God's strength until we expose our wounds and our weaknesses to him. So many of us are like, yes, I know Jesus and I've had an encounter with him, but have you been weak with him? Have you exposed your wounds to him? And if not, then we have not experienced him in his fullness, because his strength is made perfect in our weaknesses. See, exposure of our wounds to him creates dependency, and dependency creates healing. I'm gonna say that again, because for all my note takers, that's something you wanna write down and come back to. Exposure creates dependency, and dependency creates healing. Because to be healed, we have got this definition all wrong. To be healed does not mean to be absent of pain. It means to be completely one with and dependent on Jesus in spite of pain. The scripture says that it is by his stripes that we are healed. So if we were already healed a few thousand years ago, Did that understanding of being healed stop us from going through pain? No, it didn't. Because the idea is that because what Jesus did on the cross, that by those stripes, we can still be one with him and completely dependent on him no matter what we're going through. So dependency creates healing. So how do we tap? I'm a very practical person. I love a good message, but I need to get some practical nuggets out of it. I need to go home like, that sounded great, but now what do I do? So how do we tap into the weaknesses and how do we tap into our wounds and allow God to heal us for real? Anybody want to be healed for real? Anybody tired of the cliches and tired of just going through the motions, but really want some deep down inner healing? And so here's a test to see if you're truly ready to heal. If you are ready to heal, the very first thing you must do, and you got to tell me after I share it with you, if you're willing to do it. In order to heal, the first thing you got to do is acknowledge that there is a wound. You cannot heal from what you won't address. You cannot heal from what you won't address. So I'm gonna fill the room again. Are we ready to acknowledge that something hurts? Okay, so if that acknowledgement is there, that's a great first step. And some of you may be sitting and saying, okay, well, how do I even know if I have a wound? Because I've just been through so much and I just thought that's just life, right? How do I know if it's affected me? So I want to share real quick. I'm going to get to these keys, I promise, but it's so much teaching before I get to that. How do I know that there's a wound? There may be a wound if, number one, you are frequently irritable or angry. I'm gonna let that one marinate for a second. I understand that for many of us, we think that it's a part of our personality. But if you are consistently irritated, consistently angry, there might be a wound. Anger is what we call a cover-up emotion.